Hello. Hello out there. Hello. Jen, good to see you first. So for anyone just joining, I'm Kelly Phillips Badal. I'm here with Snyder Diamond, and we're going to be talking with Ryan Saghian, an interior designer in Los Angeles. Does all the celebrity work, is known for kind of his black and sexy, dark style. And he should be here any minute. And this is just to kick off a series we're calling Design in Exile. And it'll be up on Snyder Diamond's blog, which is called Design on Tap, which you should all check out. And here's Ryan. We're gonna best. It's all happening. Hey.
Hi.
I see your wine already. Excellent.
No, you guys, I'm having scotch.
Oh.
And I got these glasses at the flea market on Melrose at Fairfax High School.
And I think you just kicked this talk up a notch with
the glasses. Isn't this fabulous?
Yeah.
I'm obsessed with
these. And the scotch too.
And they just make the drink taste so much better.
Well, to kind of that,
everybody has to drink. We should all get a little buzz. We're all stuck at home, but I personally love this. Like, I'm loving being at home.
Well, that's good to hear. I feel like it's mixed. Like, some people are at their best, and some people are kind of like caged animals.
Well, look, I miss getting dressed up and going to dinner.
Yeah.
I miss going to bars and like hanging out with friends and having a few drinks and like a nice meal. But I have a client in Arizona who called me this morning, and she's very spiritual. And she's like, Ryan, you know, my rabbi was saying that those who are not grounded and need constant validation from the outside world are going to suffer and say, I need to get the fuck out of my house. You know, I can't do this anymore. Those who are spiritual and who are connected are really going to look at this time as reflection and like staying at home. Dude, I never appreciated my mom. You know, my mom drops off lunch and dinner every single day.
She does.
She's like the best woman. Like, not
only
right now, like never before, but like right now that we're going through this whole quarantine, she doesn't want me to order food. It's like, it just shows like the things you don't appreciate. You know, I don't have time to appreciate it because during the week I'm at the office or I'm with clients. But right now I have time to literally realize, wow, my mom is like really bringing me food and my dad stops by and checks on me and I'm liking it. I'm meditating and I'm really enjoying it.
Oh, good. So wait, is your mom like dropping it off outside the door, like Uber delivery style?
She leaves it outside. She's such a bitch. She won't come in. She thinks that I'm going to give her corona. I don't have corona.
I mean, we hope. We all hope.
What if I got it?
We're all crossing our fingers. No.
How would I know if I got the virus? I had symptoms.
Oh, man.
I had back pain and I had a dry cough. But it went away.
And I'm sure you've seen, like, I mean, every day I read different reports of different people having different...
Everybody in the world is getting corona.
Some mild, some
Everybody's
major.
Getting corona, but I'm not scared.
Okay, good.
I have a question, Kelly. Can we read these comments after this is done? Because it's coming in, like...
That's going to be the best part.
Oh, we can read it later?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, we'll really? Okay, so everybody comment. Everybody comment.
So, in case anyone's just joining, hi. My name's Kelly Phillips Badal. I'm just here with Snyder Diamond talking with Ryan today. And we're doing a whole series called Design in Exile because that's what we're all doing right now. We're kind of exiled from each other.
You guys, I got drunk, I swear. Are you drinking?
You've had
Kelly,
like one sip.
Kelly, drink.
You've had two sips.
No, I already finished two glasses before you came.
Oh, were you nervous, Ryan?
No, I'm just like to drink.
Please, okay. The truth comes out. Well, so we're here with Ryan. If you missed any part of this chat and you want to see more of it, we're going to post the entire thing on Snyder Diamond's blog so you can all see it later. But Ryan, one of the cool things we want to do with you is like see your house and see your kitchen.
Let's do it. Okay, so
should we
start from like the front and like enter the house?
Yeah.
So I'm going to flip it for now, okay, guys? Okay, so this is my front door. What I love about my house is, you guys, I live in West Hollywood, and it's, like, the busiest part of the city of L.A. And I'm right by the Pacific Design Center, as you can see right there.
Oh, my gosh, you can see it right
there. I'm literally in front of the Pacific Design Center. I'm on Melrose and one block above Melrose, so I'm literally in the hub. So you come from the bustling city, while bustling in LA terms. I mean, we're nothing like New York, but then you come into this like really pretty oasis, and I love it here. I do yoga here with my sister, and I'm not very good at all. I want to get a fountain right here, you guys. I think that it would be really tranquil to get like a little waterfall feature there. I think that would be fabulous. These are all covered because it's been raining, but it's black and white stripes, which match my awnings up there.
Cool.
That I just added. And
that's very French chic of you, I think. That's
very French chic. Now we're going to enter the home. Okay. So this is my entry console. The art is by Josh Young. He is one of my favorites right now. He's an artist and a designer in Chicago. And he takes these hand strokes of paint on the eyes and does like a whole series of these really cool, traditional classic portraits. The wallpaper is Maya Romanoff. You can get it if you're in LA at Thomas Lavin. And the sconces.
Is it textured or does it just
It's wood veneers. It's a wood veneer.
Wow, it's wood veneer. That's awesome.
And it's this one's called The Fans. And I have it all along the entry wall.
It's got like a kind of, I don't know, snakeskinny effect with the sconces like that too. Like bouncing.
They're wood.
Yeah.
They're really pretty. The sconces are arteriors. This is me and my mom and my sister. Where did that hair go? I have no idea. Like, look at that hair.
Bring it back.
I miss that hair, man. I just bought this in Palm Springs when I was there for Modernism. My mom thinks it's like the stupidest purchase I ever made, but I'm obsessed.
Do you use it or is it?
No, it's art. It's art.
It's art, yeah.
Yeah.
I was gonna say
the drapes. Pretty. This is from Neither Fauchère. This is Dadar. They're one of my favorite fabric houses. I love their stuff. And then somebody says, "I wish we could see only your pic, not that lady."
You'll have to flip it back to your face.
That was so funny! Oh my god. So I've basically turned this into my workstation, by the way.
Cool.
Okay, let me finish the tour. So, every year for my birthday, I buy myself a piece of art. Because my goal is to one day have a huge art collection that I can pass down. And art literally moves me. The first piece I purchased was this one. This is by Russell Young. It's Brigitte Bardot. And it's real diamond dust.
Oh, no kidding.
I bought this like five, six years ago. Then this is
Ling.
Annie Leibovitz. She did a series of, I think, 2,000 of these that she signed. And it was only like $2,500. So I'm like, okay, I'm going to get it because I know that the Helman Newton one is like $10,000 now. And he did that like 30 years ago. So maybe one day this will be worth $10,000. But I always leave it on this page because I just think it's so hot.
Yeah.
This is a Jean Marais chair. I mean, what kind of designer would I be if I didn't have at least one, right?
Hell yeah.
And this is my living room. So I love old Hollywood photography because every time I look at a photo, it reminds me of a time where everything was a little bit more opulent. And the static of the world was not as invasive because it was not as attainable. And now with social...
Where are your sources for those? Where are you getting those
from? So these
are
Sonic editions.
Okay.
I love Sonic editions. This is Roger Moore, the original James Bond. It's this photograph is called Shaken, Not Stirred. This is Roger Moore in his vintage Porsche Roadster. And this is amazing. This is Elizabeth Taylor sticking the middle finger at the bar. I love that photo. So I'm Persian and I love my culture. And Legends, you guys know Legends of La Cienega, right?
Of
course.
Once a year, Legends of La Cienega. I did it 2 years in a row, and one of the years, the theme was shaken. No, the theme. And I was like, okay, you know what my muse is? I'm very, very much inspired by my culture, by my background, by my heritage. So I did a window as an ode to Iran. And the Iran that I grew up educated about and that I knew about was the pre-revolutionary Iran, the Iran that was very much about Western ways, about Western society, when they had a regal monarchy. And when I did the whole window, I just had I had this beautiful antique Persian rug draping the window. And then in front of it, I had a huge TV that had like a series of images that the Queen of Iran sent me. Because I emailed her and I said, you know, I'm doing this. And I was like 24 at the time. So she called me with her assistant and she sent me a booklet of images, like of her with the Kennedys, with who was the other president right after Kennedy? Fuck, I always forget. It wasn't Nixon. Was it Nixon? No.
I can Google it.
I forget. Anyway, all these images, her with Barbara Walters, everything. So when I finished the window, I get this thing in the mail, and it's this amazing piece of art.
Wow,
and it's
cool.
Basically the human declaration. Okay, how do I get it so you could see it? It's the first, let me
see. It's going to be
this.
The first. Tell us what it says.
It's the first declaration of human rights of Cyrus the Great of Babylonia. And Babylonia was modern day Iran. So when I'm like, Mom, what does this mean? Why did she send this to me? She's like, she's basically saying, these are your roots. And this is where you come from and where you stem from. This amazing, exotic empire. Not this very religious, backwards thinking empire that right now is basically threatening the United States and everything. So that was a nice reminder. And I keep it right here on my bookshelf.
Yeah.
So you guys, these
you
floors
do things
were
in your house that, these floors, that like honor your Persian heritage?
Yeah, I'll show you one more thing. So let's go into the kitchen. So these are Basquiat skateboards.
Love
them. So if you can't afford $1 million Basquiat, get your hands on one of these because they're affordable. This is Jenny Binter. She's a Swedish artist. She does these sculptures.
I love this.
And then I don't know if she's still doing the pearls.
Are those butterflies?
Yeah, they're butterflies on her titties. And then this is my cousin, my mom and dad. I love these Kristoff trays. It's Kristoffel, but this collection is, what's his name? The designer of Chanel, who died. Karl Lagerfeld did this collection.
Yes.
And I love it. This is Kelly Wurstler's chess set.
Beautiful.
Another piece of art.
For anyone just joining, we're in Ryan's house, and we're going like art by art right now. In a quick little tour.
Yeah.
Someone was asking, like, this is it, right?
Yes. This is the kitchen. So this is the Empress of Iran, Farah Pahlavi. And in 1978, Andy Warhol went to Iran and did a series on the royal family. And this is a signed lithograph. And I have been waiting like 6 years to get my hands on one. Now I need to get the Shah, but I have it here in my kitchen. This is my kitchen. Okay, you guys, so I am design counsel for decor appliances. So I have to represent my decor family. They took such good care of me in my kitchen. This is my decor 36-inch dual fuel range. And I'm Kelly, what I'm going to do, I've already ordered it and I'm changing it. The door, I've ordered a black door because now they're doing color match. So the door is going to be black.
Wow.
And then the knobs are going to be brass. So it's going to be black and brass, kind of like Le
Corbusier. Oh my gosh. It's going to totally work with everything else in your apartment then.
I'm going to say one thing. I'm very upset with my followers because if out of the 100,000, if only 74 of you right now are logged in, you are so fucked up. Everybody should be logging in right now and looking at my entire house. This isn't fair. okay, so here's the kitchen. More shots of the kitchen. Heat ceramics, styled on the top, stainless steel counters. This wine station is
all black dishware. I'm guessing
fantastic.
Yeah. Oh wow.
It is the king of all wine stations, and this refrigerator You know what I love about my refrigerator is you can get these at Snyder Diamond. You get two ices, this fancy ice and the cheap garbage ice. But I like the fancy ice more. Okay, you guys, we're going into my powder room, which used to be the laundry room, but I turned it into the powder room because there was no laundry room downstairs. There's another Queen of Iran in this amazing neon acrylic frame. The wallpaper is all by Jean-Paul Gaultier, and you can get it at Schumacher. And the vanity is from Artie's Bath Collection on Wilshire.
Mm-hmm.
And there you go.
Love it.
And then my runner is from Caravan Rugs. My table is from J. Alexander. My dining chairs are from J. Alexander. My chairs are from J. Alexander. These are from J. Alexander. The sofa is J. Alexander. J. Alexander, which is my sister company, which is where my office and showroom is. And I have to keep shouting it out or else Jubin will get so mad at me. This is my Reese's Pieces inspired coffee table, also from J. Alexander. Alexander, so Jubin. You said you were watching.
Wait, go back to the Reese's Pieces coffee table because it's really perfect.
Isn't it fabulous? Yep. It's walnut.
Good enough to eat?
It's walnut. These I love. These are Daydar fabric, but I had them custom made for here. And you guys, here's a little trick. This is an Hermes horse accessory bin. It's for a, where are those areas called where you keep your horses?
Stalls. You're asking all the questions.
Yeah. It's like from a stall. It's like those horse stalls. And then like you can put like, it's literally cardboard and it's so not expensive. And I just used it as a side table.
Stable.
And Jay Alexander custom designed this sofa. I did this with them. It's leather buckles. Stables. Elon just answered. Yeah. It's for horse stables. And my stairs are like the hit of my house. They're acrylic. These are acrylic stairs. They're really scary, but I love walking up these stairs naked whenever my lover is sitting down over here because they could see everything as you dangle upstairs. Oh my God. I just make myself laugh. I'm crazy. So you guys, ask questions. Like, what do you guys want to know? No, the lighting.
Well, so I want to ask you some quarantine questions too. Like, you know.
The lighting here is so much better. What were you saying?
Okay, so quarantine questions for sure. And then.
Yeah, what are your quarantine questions? Come in. What are your quarantine questions?
My quarantine questions. So like, you know, you were saying at the very beginning of this conversation that you've been meditating and that you feel good alone, like you're at peace. But
I
like,
love it. This is the best.
How are you keeping
your
brain active and creativity going?
What keeps me active?
Yeah, just your brain active and your creativity.
So the first few days I would like sleep in till like 12 and it was really, really, really bad. And I really didn't like it. I didn't know how to navigate this whole new. Oh, you guys, I have to do a marketing thing. You need to go go buy my candle.
I love seeing your signature on that candle.
Okay, so what was I saying? Yeah, so the first few days, like, it was confusing. Like, how do I navigate this? And then I was like, okay, you need to give yourself a schedule. So I woke up at, I used to wake up at 6:30, but now, like, I'm going to take advantage of the fact that I don't have to wake up that early. And I wake up at, like, 8:30, 9 o'clock.
That sounds good.
It's fine. I'm home. You know, I don't have to get ready to go to work or anything.
You're not commuting.
I'm not commuting. Yeah. I go in the backyard. I do some push-ups. I make myself a coffee. I come inside. I'm already a little wired because the push-ups woke me up. The coffee woke me up. And I'm just on my computer. And we're FaceTiming with Elon, with Shayna, with Shanaz. Like, just getting everything going in the office. I will say, so when I'm designing, I have two phases, construction phase and furniture phase, okay? Furniture phase is more of a luxury. You're already in the house. Construction phase, you need to get in the house, you know, because you're paying two mortgages. You're paying rent somewhere and you're waiting for your house to be completed. So all of my construction projects have continued. And I have a lot of deadlines and a lot of drawings and a lot of things that I need to get done and submitted and give it to the contractor, give it to the architect, submit it to the city, get permits and everything. Those are going, and thank God for those, because I'm like busy working on those. Furniture phase projects, everybody's kids are home. Nobody has time right now. Everybody has said pause, 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 stall, stall, stall. So the cash flow is a little fucked right now, you know? And we're suffering because we're not commodities, we're luxuries. Our industry is a luxury. So unless it's construction phase, everything has paused.
So how many projects do you have going on right now that are like construction versus ready to furnish?
Right now I'm at 6 construction.
Must be a lot of furnishing.
6 construction, 7 furniture phases. So we're at 14 projects, and 7 of them have been halted.
Shoot. Yeah.
It's crazy. It's crazy. So what ends up happening is you have so much more time on your hands to like literally sit, and I'm creating a lighting collection. So I've just been sitting there sketching lighting designs. I'm creating a rug collection. I've been sitting there sketching new rug designs. Let's get really deep here for a second. I have buried myself in the last 4 years with my work. And anytime something like really hard would happen in my life, I would bury myself in my work. It was my savior. It was my salvation. Like my work was what gave me purpose, is what gave me life, and it was what kept me distracted. And it's still there, but there's less of it. So now there's a lot more time on my hands to think. I'm also somebody that this house was always filled with people, friends, parties. It was always filled with people, and I never had alone time.
Yeah.
And now I'm sitting there and I'm feeling things that I may have like literally covered up with work or with social life. And that's what this to me, everything in life is connected. Every single thing in life is connected. And when people say, well, I really want this, or I really want this in my career, or I really want this in my life, but how am I going to do it?
Yeah.
In spiritual, metaphysical perspective, they would say that it's not your responsibility to figure out how to do it. You just have to want it and go for it. That's the universe's domain. So we can't really sit there and say why certain things happened or how they happened. But if I want to look at this from a positive perspective, I really think that we as a community of people, as a society, as like human beings, have really taken advantage of our surroundings, of our planet. And we've gotten to this very unauthentic place. And this is the universe literally trying to snap everybody back into consciousness. Like, wake the fuck up. Like, you have no idea what really is important and what really matters. And people are going to realize that it doesn't matter what eco-socioeconomical background you come from. You could be the richest person in town, or you could be a bum on the street. And this is going to affect you, you know?
Yeah.
Actually, I think this is going to affect more of the high society people, because they're the travelers and they're the ones that have been going in and out of the country and bringing the disease or the virus to their places of living. So I actually think this is a virus that started amongst the elite versus the lower class.
You might be right, because, I mean, the people who have the means to travel are the ones that spread it so easily. And everything,
you know what I mean?
So
totally. Like,
everyone's so interconnected.
And like in New York, I have a large group of, I have some clients in New York, and I have a large group of friends in New York. And a lot of people in New York got it from a few people. Like, I know the Jewish community there. A lot of people got it from a few people who went to AIPAC in Washington, D.C., That is a group of people that have a lot of money that donate to a major organization that helps support the Jewish government of the United States. And those people came back and they gave it to a lot of people. Those were not peasants. Those were not the lower class. Those were elite, wealthy, Jewish, Iranian people. And it hits you in the face. Like,
right.
You know?
I know.
Kelly, I really don't want to get it.
Yeah.
I really don't want to get it. And they're saying that half of LA,
I mean, why would you want to?
Yeah. I don't want to be that half.
Well, you're doing the right thing. You're
quarantined. I'm staying home.
You're doing all this
Kelly,
stuff.
Kelly, how come you're not drinking your drink?
Oh yeah, I need to step it up. Don't. I know, I'm like leaning in, like listening.
What else should I show you? Should I take you upstairs? The only thing is, Barishop wants to do an exclusive for upstairs. Fuck it, I'll take you upstairs. Let's go upstairs.
It's up to you.
Let's go upstairs, guys.
Yeah, let's go upstairs too. I'm into it.
Okay, so these are my stairs. Oh, you guys, I really want to give a shout out to these two amazing artists. This is Skylar Ethan. Oh, yeah. He is an LA-based artist. He is so talented. He is so amazing. He made this for me as a gift when I bought this house.
I love it.
And I love it. He knows that I'm the black and white guy, so he really did a great
job. You're the king of black and white.
This is by Carla Cascala. Yeah, I love black and white. This is by Carla Cascala. She is an incredibly talented Spanish artist and sculptor. She is represented by Tappan Collective here in LA, and this just is everything for me. It hangs on wire. I'm going to zoom in for you because everybody who comes over really dies over this.
Yeah, get in close. Oh, wow.
This hangs on a piece of aircraft wire off of this brass, like, hook, and it just hangs like this, and it's fabulous. It's fabulous. All right, guys, we're going upstairs. Now you're getting a whole zoom of my whole house.
Yes. There's the kitchen again.
We are going up. We're going up. We're going up.
So, Ryan, you own this house, right?
Yes, I bought it last year.
Bit by bit by bit.
I bought it last year.
Just last year? Mm-hmm. Oh, my gosh. Okay, so you've been working on this the whole time then.
Yes, and come on. You guys, look at this. Look at this photograph. It is fabulous. This is Faye Dunaway when she won her Oscar. And she's sitting by the pool at the Beverly Hills Hotel. Look at that photo.
And is then that a this newspaper is another ball around her legs? I love it.
It's on metal. This is another photo by Skylar Ethan. It's Kate Moss. It's hanging in my stairway. I love this one. And then this is my bedroom.
That's what we've all been waiting for.
Yes. You guys, my bed's not made. I'm so sorry. I'm so embarrassed. My bed's not made. But this wallpaper is from Bijou Coverings in New York. They are also the manufacturers of the Ryan Saghian wallpaper collection. They have the best stuff ever. Yeah. You know, a long time ago, someone told me that purple is an aphrodisiac. So I decided to make my bed purple so that every time somebody walks into my bedroom, they just want to drop their pants. And this is my nightstand from ART Furniture. And that is me. You guys, where did that hair go? Look at that hair.
I love that you're keeping all these pictures of yourself around the apartment.
Right?
To remind yourself of that hair.
Minotti, I love you, Mary. Mary is the fucking shit. This is my brand new. You guys, look at this. It's fox fur.
Is this a blanket?
Oh, I died for this. It's so fabulous. I was not involved in the killings of these animals. Somebody said he loves himself. Well, I hope that you love yourself too, because, you know, it starts with yourself.
We should all love ourselves.
Yeah, how is anybody else going to love you if you don't love yourself? I'm sorry that you don't love yourself. This is my closet. And yes. This is my master bathroom. There you go. It was a mess up here. I'm so embarrassed. I showed this to you. You guys, I need to get a runner here.
Oh, yeah.
I need a runner there. I need a runner there. I need a runner there. This room is empty. You guys, I think I'm going to turn this into a massage room. Look, there's nothing in here.
Yes.
Nothing. Nothing in here. And my steamer. Oh, and let me show you my little yard. Okay. So this is my yard. Nice.
There's the front yard.
No, this is the backyard.
Oh, wait. We're in the backyard now.
And then, you know why I bought this house, you guys? Because this house has a cottage in the back. Look at that.
Oh, wow.
And I rent out the cottage to a lovely, lovely architect. She's amazing. And I'm going to find a better photo of the cottage for you. Hold on. I'm going to go to this bathroom right here. Oh, you can't see it. I'm so sorry. You can't see it. Well, there's a cottage back there. Now we're going back downstairs with my acrylic stairs. This is so fun. I'm really enjoying this.
So I want to know, you know, what are you feeling grateful for right now? Or what are you appreciating the most about being home?
What do I appreciate the most about being home?
Or just feeling grateful for in general. Like, we've touched on this a little, but, you know, I feel like this is a whole time for reflection right now. Is there anything that you're like, oh, I'm actually glad this is happening so I can do X or feel X?
I'm feeling a lot more authentic with myself. I'm realizing... Yeah.
Why?
Why? You guys, I don't know where you guys are from, whoever is, like, watching. LA is very... The soul of LA, and people always say, LA doesn't have a soul, LA doesn't have culture. Bullshit. LA has a lot of soul, LA has a lot of culture. It's just Hollywood. It's Hollywood infused. It's the birthplace of Hollywood. So there's a very large lack of authenticity here. Because everybody is trying to be somebody that they are not. And as a native, it's a lot more apparent because I just watch a lot of transplants, and it's not to like separate us and put us into two completely different like brackets, but like you watch people who come here with these dreams of being like the next Hollywood star or the next big thing, and you watch their souls slowly get crushed and crushed and crushed by the static of what is LA. And if you can't appreciate LA for what it actually is,
yeah,
you can get very, very lost in what you think it should be and what you think you should be. And at times, although I feel like I am somewhat of a very grounded person, I find myself completely driven by my ego. And not because I'm weak or anything, but because the ego... You know, people always say the ego is not your true self. The ego is not your true self. Well, it's not your true self, but it actually uses your own intelligence against you because at the end of the day, it is you. It may not be your real self, but it uses your own intelligence against you. And it's very sophisticated. And how many times have you thought about something, Kelly, and it left your mind and then it came back disguised as something else in another situation?
Right.
And then it left again. And then it came back again in another situation disguised again. And it's that ego that sometimes really gets me. And right now, there's no ego because I'm home. And the only other person here is me. And there's no judgment here. And there's nobody to say anything. And the static of the world, again, is just not there. And I can sit in the peacefulness of my own home. And I can go and find the most beautiful pieces of furniture. The most beautiful pieces of art. And it's just me and me. There's nobody else. And it's beautiful. I'm loving it. I don't have to worry about getting up in the morning and wearing the right outfit. I don't have to worry about getting up in the morning and wearing gym clothes to go to the construction site and then wondering what's my client going to think that I'm not like dressed up. I don't give a fuck anymore, you know? Appreciating my mom. Like, my office is on Robertson and 3rd. My parents live on Lapeer. It's like 3 blocks away. And I never would go. Ever. I would just never go. I would order food to the office and then me and my whole team would have lunch. Now I see my mom every day because she drops off lunch. And I'm stopping and I'm like texting my friends who are like, I can't go visit my parents in New York because I'm stuck in LA and, you know, domestic flights are canceled. And I'm appreciating the fact that my mom can literally bring me lunch, you know?
Hey, what's your mom making you for lunch? I want to know.
You know, some of it's not good. Of it's not good. She's experimenting a lot. She's trying to make Chinese food, and she's a Persian Jewish woman.
Oh, she is.
And it was really, really disgusting. Imagine having chicken, vegetables, and all of this, like, her own version of chow mein with Persian basmati rice. It was, like, really bad. But some days she kills it with her kebabs and her, like, you know, her stews. Other days I order Postmates, but I just saw something on ABC7 that the Postmates people who are picking up your food are picking into your food and eating it. So that's
I'm not gonna believe that. God, I can't even think about that.
They had cameras that caught people digging into their food. And
oh God, no.
I'm
the one thing you have left.
I don't like to cook because I have to clean it, so I don't love it. but I'm cooking a little. Yeah, she's bringing me food. I've gotten a lot closer with my sister.
Does she live here too? Is she in LA?
She lives in LA, yeah. She just moved back. Yeah. She moved back a year ago. She was in Israel for a good year and a half. She loves it there.
Wow, okay.
I think my sister's going to marry an Israeli and move to Israel.
Okay.
I think that's what's going to happen. But I'm really enjoying it. And you guys really need to take advantage of this. It's really an amazing time. And you don't have to worry because mortgages are halted. Your credit card bills are halted. This is the time where you can sit the fuck at home and just relax and take advantage of that. It's so amazing. Are you guys kidding me? It's amazing. The only bad thing is my boyfriend won't come over because he has a boss who's crazy and says that he can't see anybody. And it's like a VIP person, so like whatever. And I am very sexually deprived. And I'm sure a lot of people whose boyfriends won't come see them or whose lovers or whatever. And that's the sad part, really, because, you know, but if I had like a person here, I'd be boning left and right all night.
But you don't have any pets or anything too, right?
I do, but she lives with my parents. And everybody's like, bring your dog and bring her with you. But I feel bad because like the dog adds a lot of light to the house and like my parents, they kind of need that. It's like none of their kids live at home. Forced to relax, forced to relax and just be. I'm relaxed, baby. I'm so relaxed.
I mean, I think it's kind of refreshing to hear you say that you actually find yourself good company, because I think there's a lot of people that they're a little worried just being in their heads all the time. Like, that's hard.
No, you guys. The only way to get over anything in your life is to feel it. Mm-hmm. The most painful part of my life was when I was 21 years old and I had to come out of the closet. And I could have numbed my pain by doing a lot of drugs or eating a lot of food or hanging out with a lot of the wrong people, but I numbed myself by working. And I really do say that now that I've gained a lot more perspective. I really think a huge part of my success at that time, or right now at this age, was working at 15 years old and working for Ron and Jamie, Woodson and Rummer Fields, who literally molded me into the person that I am today. And I think I lost, I forgot that for a while. I thought that, like, I just stopped feeling for a little bit because I didn't want to feel. And if you feel, you'll have a few days, a few weeks, and at maximum a few months of pain, but you'll get over it because you'll digest it. But if you don't feel, it always comes back. It never disappears. You can never numb your pain, ever, 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 ever.
So I want to know how you got into interior design, you know, as you're touching on that a little bit. So like, how did you get started?
People ask me that all the time. So I was 15 years old, in high school, very empty and very lost. And, you know, most 15-year-olds, you know, they're dating girls, they're going out, they're partying, they're drinking, they're doing all that, like, fun stuff. I had a very big empty spot in my heart and in my soul. And at that time, this is, like, way before social media. This is, like, the MySpace days and, like, the blogger days. This is whenever Cupcakes and Cashmere first became a blog, if you know Cupcakes and Cashmere. And I would go on these blogs, and I would always see this black guy and this white girl. And I used to think that the black guy was married to the white girl. So I thought that there was hope. I could be an interior designer, maybe with my wife or something, you know? And that was Woodson and Rummerfield, Ron and Jamie. And I sent them an email. I was like their biggest fan. And I said, I will do anything. I will sharpen your pencils. I will clean your toilet. I will like organize your library. I just have to work for you. And Jamie, I remember her assistant called me and said, Jamie wants to meet you. I met with Jamie. I said, I'm 15. I don't even have my license yet, but my mom can drop me off every day after school. And this is La Cienega before there's any LCDQ. This is like, there's Kelly Wurstler, Woodson and Rummerfield, and that's it. No one else is on La Cienega, but like a few other stores. And I was working for Ron and Jamie as an intern. I became an assistant while I was in college. And I stayed there for 5 years, and then at 21, I graduated college. I got my bachelor's in interior design from the Art Institute of California. And my dad turned the garage into a little studio for me. And I started doing small projects for like my cousin's friends and friends of my family and so on. And it just grew and it grew and it grew and it grew. And it's my salvation. It is literally a career from the heart. I love what I do. I love it.
So are you, I saw this question come up in the comments a little bit. So I just want to ask, like, are you doing like e-consulting with your clients? Are you just doing lots of phone calls and FaceTime?
Like right now during this time?
Yeah, right now during
Zoom
this time.
Zoom and FaceTime. And today I had a client call me and say, Ryan, like they're so confused about where to put the tile. And I really don't want to make any mistakes. Yeah. Please just wear a mask and stop by. And I did that.
Okay, yeah.
But yeah, it's a lot of like FaceTime and like Zoom and things like that. But it's fine.
Yeah. Are all the projects you're working on in LA? Are they ones that you can?
No, there's one in New York that got. There's two in New York that are completely stopped. There's one in Arizona that is going, and
yeah,
we are doing Zoom and FaceTime and text going back and forth, and the rest are all in LA. I had one in San Francisco that finished. And that's it. Yeah.
Yeah. And I don't think this would happen, but like if every project of yours completely stopped, what would you do? Like what would you do then? I don't know if you thought down this road. We're gonna do
what would I do if all my projects stopped?
Yeah. Like if you that like really blows your time open. Why? Man.
What would I do? I would take a lot of LSD and I would sit at home and try.
This is the answer I was waiting for.
I don't know, you guys. That would be horrible.
Yeah.
That would be really sad. I don't know what I would do.
I mean, I think that's key, actually. Like, we don't know. Like that hasn't happened yet. It hasn't gone that extreme yet. But, like, I don't know. I don't think that will happen. We're all going to bounce back.
No, we're going to bounce back. I went to a meeting
a
few days ago. I went to a psychic medium. Because I really wanted to know what was happening. And she said the vibration of coronavirus has gone down and that within the next few weeks, we're going to just see it like slowly going away. I mean, I really don't know. If I lost all of my clients, I don't know what I wouldn't be able to afford this house. I would call my bank and say I can't afford the mortgage.
Yeah. Yeah, I feel like that's what everyone's end game is like. They're like, well, then, you know, if everything stops, then I just can't do this life that I'm currently doing.
What are we gonna do? No, that's not going to happen. I don't think like that. You guys, I really don't have a negative.
You can't think like that.
Don't have a negative neurosis. Worrying is like praying for the worst possible outcome. Stop worrying. The universe has your back. Just sit back and relax. Take this as an opportunity to really get to know yourself. I guarantee you that you don't know yourself because you've conditioned yourself to think that you're supposed to be a certain way.
Yeah.
So just fuck that.
Well, you don't get this time to think about yourself. And like, I that's what I think.
I'm thinking about myself. Are you kidding me? I'm crazy. I have a lot of problems in here. You really need to sit and digest all of this stuff that goes through here.
Yeah.
Somebody is saying, I'm homebody, we're going to be okay.
Yeah.
We're getting a lot of messages. I mean, we've kept a stable 60 the whole way through. So I think if no one had ever gone out, we would be at 3,000-4,000 right now. Because people are coming in and out, but we're stabling at max. Now we're at 54, but we've been stabling at 60. So I think in total, if you think of 60 within the hour, we're at like 2,000. So 2,000 people have been in and out. So still, that's not enough. I have 100,000 followers. There should be more than 2,000 people tuning in. But you guys,
I just trimmed my beard.
And I need to get a haircut because I have not been able to cut my hair.
And we're going to see some real interesting hair by the end of this, I think.
What do you think the aftermath
is? I trimmed my own bangs.
What do you think the aftermath is going to be? Are people going to be so socially awkward?
Oh, no. I think it's going to be the total opposite. I think we're going to all want to, like, hug each other and be together. And there's going to be, like, the craziest after parties. And hopefully it doesn't set off another round of infection. Ah, okay. I can't think like that. Like, that's the sort of thing.
Yeah,
But I think it's going to change. I think it's going to change a lot of things, like, maybe forever. Like, even things like maybe all these meetings don't have to be in person. Maybe a lot of them can be on email or Zoom or whatever. But... Yeah. I don't know. It's even like little things like that.
I really do appreciate you because, like, you know, I'm a younger designer, and this is an industry that really is not like fashion, and I say it all the time. The fashion industry really they love the next best thing. They love the young designers, and the editors of the publications of the fashion world really they really grab the young designers and they really put them under their wing. And I've watched it, and I've watched the growth of the young design community in the fashion world. But in the interior design world, there's a lack of that, and it's very backwards. And the shelter magazines are consistently publishing the same people over and over and over again. And it's so hard for young talent to get recognized and to be respected and to have their work, you know, showcased on a editorial platform. And you were really, really good to me by publishing one of my projects in Beverly Hills. And whenever Modern Luxury, I'll never forget that. You were amazing.
Oh, good. I love that project.
I'm so
dark and sexy as all your projects. It's the first of many. It's going to be the first of many for sure. So
yeah, first of many.
All right. Well, cool. Well, Ryan, this was awesome. Happy to talk to you face to face. And like, you know, anyone who didn't get to see all of Ryan's apartment, including like the sexy upstairs rooms and the kitchen and everything, all the art. We're going to post it on Snyder Diamond's blog, Design on Tap.
Yes, I can't wait.
Whole crazy conversation again.
I'm going to do it too.
Yeah, yeah, because that would be awesome. Because there's some gems in here. There's some serious gems in here and some, you know, and some drinking, but some gems.
I love it. I love it. Kelly, you are so cute and your bangs look amazing. My client cut her bangs and she fucked them.
Oh, my God. Thanks.
They look great.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, especially for saying that.
You're welcome.
I was like, this is going to be a hot mess. No. Okay.
All right, guys.
Any final thoughts you want to leave us all with?
You guys, I am stuck to my phone. I am home. So I am reading for the first time in years my requested messages.
Send him suggestions.
So message me away. Ask me anything. And ask me what you want to see and I will post it. Okay, I'm here. So message away.
Yeah. I mean, Ryan, I feel like you're posting inspiration all the time.
All day!
Stories.
A lot of Ryan is coming out on social media right now.
Yes. Yes. Okay, well, thank you again.
Bye, guys.
This was such a pleasure.
I had a lot of fun.
Bye, Ryan. Bye. Thank you.
How do you leave?